He comes up and gives us a message. All right. Thank you, guys.
You're good. All right, good morning again. I am going to get a stool out this week. We'll see if this will last here. We're having some printer issues, and so that's why I brought my computer with me. And I'm going to go through some notes with you guys this morning. We are going to start a new series today, and we're going to just be a three-week series called Tell Them I Love Them, because it's February, so it's what? Love month. Who? Anybody here like that hates Valentine's? You can be real. All right. They're always the real bold ones. Yeah. A lot of people don't love Hallmark holidays for some reason, and I don't know why that is. I am a sucker for Hallmark holidays, right, dear? Yes. When I married my wife, she had one pair of pearls. Yeah, now she got a big old jewelry box. Now it's all from, you know, cheap places. Don't get any. What's that place called? Charlotte. Charming Charlie's. Little shout out to Charming Charlie's. It's all fake. But I love to buy her stuff. I think Hallmark holidays are absolutely the best thing. But I know that many people think they're ridiculous and can't stand them. And so when you're going through a church calendar trying to plan series and February comes, you're supposed to just talk about love, right? That's just kind of what you're supposed to do, at least in America, because we follow the American calendar of Hallmark holidays and then govern our churches. And so, anyways, no one got that? Y'all okay? Everybody good? Hey, by the way, shout out to our online people. What's up? I always forget that. It's not in my notes. Not that we don't remember you. We just forget. Anyways, thanks for tuning in. All right, so the series today is going to be a little more chill than normal, all right? That's why I got the stool, because I'm just going to do some more talking. I can't promise I won't preach, but this is more of a talking type series, because what I thought we would do for the next 3 weeks is talk about the love of God. So all you people who hate Valentine's Day, you can still listen. You don't have to, like, tune out. This applies to you as well. Instead of talking about love and how we should love each other and all that, which all is impacted by how we love God, by the way, and how we understand God's love for us, what would it be like to talk for a few weeks simply about the love of God? And so a few months ago, I was going through series ideas, and I'm like, what do we talk about in February? And this phrase that came up to me is a phrase that comes up all the time. This phrase, tell them I love them. If you don't know some of my story, in 2011 or 12, Kelsey and I planted a church up in Michigan, and we planted the church under God's house. So God's house at the first in the first parts of when we launched out, like held our finances and all that kind of stuff. We got our paperwork in order. So we were affiliated with God's house. So we basically were our own church up in Michigan. And the first service we had was the first time I ever had preached a message in a church. I had taught like for youth group and I taught for stuff like that, but I had never actually preached in a church on my own. I had had opportunities to speak at events, but it always was with somebody else that was a lot smarter than me, you know? Like, they're like, yeah, we'll put you up there with the guy who's got 14 master's degrees and 2 doctorates, and here's DJ next to him. And so when we started our church, I'd never preached. And so we had this little church that we rented that sat about, what, 25, 30 people. It had the ugliest orange pews, but they just mean so much to me that I love those pews still when I see them, like vintage. And then we decided we'd just like rock out the orange pews, so we bought like flowers and stuff to match them and just embrace the orange. So our church color was just orange, so there's like orange flowers and orange lights, and it was very 70s type church. And so, not in style, just in look. And so I'd go over to that little sanctuary once a week to get ready for Sunday, because I didn't know how you prepare a message. Now when I prepare messages, I'm kind of always preparing. Someone asked me the other day, how do you prepare a message? And I said, I don't know how to answer that because everyone's different, but I'm usually working on 14 messages at once. Like, that's how my phone, you can show you the notes. Like, I've got notes in here for a message, for a series we're doing in April. I got a book I'm trying to write, so I got all those notes. I just, like, my brain works like that. But some people, you know, tell you, you got to go sit in one spot and you got to, like, this is how you prepare a message. So I didn't know what to do, so I went over to the little orange pewed building, and it was empty, and I stood up on the little platform, which is about, like, this high, right here, and I looked out over the empty pews, and I went, what do I say? And so I remember saying to God these words, God, what do I say to these people that are coming? Like, I don't know what I'm supposed to tell these people, and I've never preached before. What do I say? And I remember God saying, tell them I love them. And in my mind, I was like, well, that seems kind of simple, God, and I'd really like something a little more theological, so they think that, you know, all those training years I went through, they think I got something out of it, you know, like something more like, let's talk about the exegesis of the whatever. I don't even know what that is, but, you know, so he said, no, tell them I love them. And I said, well, God, I don't even know what that means. And so I remember the service starting, and I didn't have any notes because God just said to tell them that he loved them. And the service started and worship began, and I got up on our little platform that was not even higher than our floor, and worship was wrapping up, and I got on the microphone. We had this little cool little microphone and this little Bose, little something, someone donated this little Bose sound system. It was really cool. We were legit, guys. It was amazing. And we had our cool little overhead projector lights. It was awesome. And so I got up, and I remember looking out at the 20 people there, and I just said these words, God loves you. And I just started declaring over them about God's love for them. God loves you so much that if you are the only person left in the world, a lot of the stuff you hear me do during worship here, and I just started declaring over them that it doesn't matter what you did last night, it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter what you've done, God loves you. And I watched as these 20 people broke. People I'd never seen express much emotion before start sobbing and crying. And in that moment, I was like, God, what is this? And he said, my love for them. I told you to tell them that I loved them. And when my love hits them, it breaks through every barrier, every boundary, every wrong mindset, everything that anyone has ever said against you begins to disintegrate when you understand the love of God. There's nothing that you can do. The Bible says nothing can separate you from the love of God. There's nothing. And so in preparing for this month, I thought, well, then let's just talk about what God told me at the beginning, because sometimes it's just good to go back to the first where you first started, right? And remember when God really moved. And so I was thinking about February and Love Month, and I just wrote, I texted Wesley, our worship leader, and I said, I just want to do a series called Tell Them I Love Them. And for a couple weeks, I just want to tell you that God loves you. Is that okay? Yeah. So today what we're going to look at is we're going to look at the love of God through the eyes of a parent. Now, I know that I lose a lot of you right there, because our church has a lot of college students, and some of you, even parents, that are not parents, some of you people who are married or are adults don't have kids, and so you're like, oh, great, it's not for me. Here's the deal about parents. You either are a parent or you have one. That took a long time to come up with. Just kidding. You either are a parent or you have a parent. And so when you're talking about parenting, what emotions come up for some of you could be really good because you had a great childhood or you've had a great experience with your kids, or could be really bad because you had a terrible childhood and you think of a parent as an abuser or someone that condemned you and someone that didn't accept you, or maybe you've lost a child and you've gone through this, the emotion of the grief of what it feels like to, as a parent, to grieve the loss of a child. And so when you talk about parenting, there's a whole lot of emotions that come up. And so what I want to do today in talking about God as our parent is explain to you the true characteristics of a parent through the eyes of God and the way that he loves you like we would love our kids. If you got your Bible this morning, we're just going to go to a very familiar verse, so you may not even need to open your Bible. In fact, if you grew up in church, you shouldn't need to open your Bible. There should be a test on this. We're going to look at John 3:16. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish. One translation says will not perish, but have eternal life. There's another verse in 1 John chapter 3. In the first part of verse 1, it says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. Did you know that you're a child of the living God? Like, you have a parent here on earth, but you are a child of God. And to start talking about God's love and trying to explain the love of God, it's really hard to do. In fact, in Proverbs, Solomon is writing in Proverbs chapter 30, and he talks about how love is such a mystery. He talks about there's three things and four things that I can't even fathom. I can't even explain, because how do you explain something as great as God's love for us? He loves us so much that we can't even know the depth of his love. I love this quote from John Eldridge in the book Sacred Romance. He says, "We come into the world with a longing to be known and a deep-seated fear that we aren't what we should be." To understand the love of God fully, you have to understand that God created you who you are just as you are on purpose. And sometimes our culture, and sometimes the church especially, has done a really poor job at telling everyone that in order for you to be a follower of Christ and receive the love of God, you need to look like I look and act like I act and do what I do, right? You all probably aren't Hillsong fans in this church. I mean, there probably are some Hillsong fans, but that's what I do. I listen to Hillsong all day long. I watch Bishop T.D. Jakes. I'm kind of weird. Like, you know, most 31-year-olds are like, I don't know what they listen to, because I, K-Love, not K-Love, Janet. Janet, that's not for the 31-year-olds, that's for the M's. So sorry. I can't help it. We have this internal argument on our staff about Caleb, because I just don't really like Christian music. I love worship music, but I'm not a contemporary Christian music person. I like worship and I like country. So anyways, but I love Hillsong and I love listening to preachers. And so a lot of times in church, we've like convinced everyone that if I'm the pastor, then you all just need to do what I do. So we're going to sell Hillsong CDs out in the lobby, and Bishop Jakes, we can't afford him, but he's going to come in here and tear the house down. It'd be amazing. But that's not the truth. God created you the way you are, unique in how you are, and the way that you respond to the world is why you are the way you are, because he made you that way. And so from the very beginning of this series, I want you to understand the love of God for you is so deep that this deep-seated desire in you that John Eldridge is talking about, that you just have this longing to be known, you are known by God. He knows you. He loves you. He sees you right where you are. It doesn't mean that he loves all the things that you need to get right and he's just sitting there going, good job, messing it up again. He's not looking at all that stuff. He's looking at the you of you that he created in his image. And he says, I love you. And so what does it look like to talk about God through the eyes of a parent? The first thing I want to just kind of even talk about to you for when it comes to a parent, and the reason I use the word parent instead of just the word father, is because we always refer to God in the masculine form of father, and that's English in the way that it's been translated down generations after generations. And obviously when Jesus came into the world, he came in as a male, but God is not a human. Like, God is not a male or female. God is a being. And so a lot of times I think you ladies don't get enough credit. And we have just convinced ourselves that God only looks like what a man does and man characteristics. And then when someone comes and shows a whole lot of compassion or shows a lot of tenderness or just shows the heart of a mom, we're like, well, that's just sappy. No, that's God. God created my wife way better than he created me, if we're being real, y'all. But when I watch the way Kelsey interacts with Weston, that's how I want God to interact with me. There's a verse, let's just get right into it, all right? I'm just going to be chill today. Is that okay, guys? Isaiah 49, chapter 15. It says, "Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget," this is God talking, he says, "I will not forget you. See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me." And so God looks at you not through the eyes of just a father. He also looks at you through the eyes of a mother, because God is not a sex. And please don't send me an email and say I'm getting all whatever. Like, I'm just being real. God is a being, all right? I'm not one of those pastors that gets up and says, I don't think Jesus was a man. I think he was, because that's what it says. But God is a being that was not created in the image of anything. He created us in his image. And Genesis chapter 1 says that he created male and female in his image. And for too long in the church, we've talked about God as he's just this big papa daddy, right? Pimp daddy God up there. And then we see the heart of a mother. For crying out loud, we get a Pope who looks like Jesus. And we're like, oh no, oh, that ain't God. Jesus, he's all about, you know, God, he's all about just the war and the might and the power. And that is part of it. I need that might in my life. That's what we were bringing down here in worship this morning. But sometimes you need someone to hold you. Sometimes you need someone to look at you and to love you right where you are. This week, Weston went to bed at about, he's been going to bed about 7. The kid's sleeping like 13 hours. Can we just get a holla? We are normal again. This is only our first child, so I'm sure we'll go through stages of not being normal. But he woke up at about midnight, and Kelsey had just worked a couple nights in a row, or a couple days in a row, and so our agreement usually is that when she works, she puts him to bed because she is way better at routine than I am. I'm just being real. They have their little routine. They change the diaper. They put his little essential oils behind his ear. They read their Bible. They say their prayers. And they say amen, and Weston goes like this, which we did not teach him. I don't know. The kid's a little worshiper because his dad likes Hillsong. And so then when he wakes up, if Kelsey has to work, I have to go get him. Well, my attitude's not always like a loving father. Can I just be real? Sometimes I just want to love my sleep more than I want to love my child. And I said to Kelsey, I said, you go get him. And she was like, I have to go to work. Like, you go get him. And I was like, oh, okay. So I was laying there for like 2 minutes. And finally she starts moving. And I was like, where are you going? She's like, well, I'm going to go get him. I was like, no, I got him. So I get up and I go into his room. And he's just crying. And I don't know why he was crying that night. He's just sobbing and he's crying. And so I grabbed him. And I'd gone upstairs and got his milk. And so I just sat down in this little chair we have in his room. And I took his milk and I gave it to him. And immediately he stopped crying. And he's just drinking the milk. Now, Weston's 18 months old now, so it's not like when he was, you know, when 2 pounds when he was born. Like, he's, like, you know, long like this. And he's sitting here in my arms, and his little head is just leaned on my arm, like, into my chest. And he falls back asleep. And I could have put him back in his crib after a minute and a half. But I sat there for, like, 45 minutes. Because there's nothing more beautiful as a parent than watching your child sleep. And if you don't have kids, you're like, well, that's not fair. Here's the deal. There's nothing more beautiful to your parent than watching you sleep. Do you ever notice college students? Like, yes. Some of you parents with young kids are like, amen. Do you ever notice college students when you go home? And we find this too because we live away from our family. So we'll go home for Christmas time. And this happens both in my house and Kelsey's house. We're in our parents' house. You know, you show up and you got your nice clothes and you're ready to open gifts and you come in and the Christmas tree's there. And after about 3 hours, you're all in your pajamas and hoodies and you're just like sitting down and my dad's just bringing us food because my dad loves to bring food all the time. And we're watching Christmas movies and we're playing games and it's loud and it's obnoxious and the house is a mess because we've just had, you know, 10 people opening gifts everywhere. And you look at your mom, and what's she doing? Smiling. She's in heaven. Not because you are sitting there saying, Mom, I'm so sorry for everything bad I ever said to you, and I was a terrible child, and I know my attitude sucked when I was 14. And so, no, like, you're just there, and you're sitting in her presence, and she's so fulfilled because she just wants to see you. My dad is bringing us food. Kelsey's parents are the same way when we go there. They're just like, here, you need more. I'm like, we are going to gain 1 million pounds here. Like, you, I know you guys don't eat like this when we're not here because you're not overweight. And so, like, they, like, keep, here, have more. We just had steak, and now let's go out for ice cream and then come back and eat some pie. And then, I mean, it's like, and they don't live. I asked Kelsey when I first met her. I was like, do your parents do this all the time? And she was like, no, it's just when we come home. Why? Because they want to bring every possible good thing they have to you. Because the fact that you are just there with them is the heart of a parent for their child. That is how God feels about you. That's how he feels about you. Yeah, you can clap about that because that's good. Because he feels about me that way too. And I don't care what kind of parent you had. You see, this is what happens sometimes in our lives. We have parents in our world who weren't, here's what I want you to hear, weren't loved like God loved them. And so their response was not to love you the way you should have been loved. Because it's a cycle, right? You know, most abusive parents and parents who were treated their kids poorly did not happen because they just got up one day and said, I want to be a bad parent. It's because they were never fully shown the love of God through the eyes of their parent. So how can they show what they don't know? right? And so, but if you have had any kind of experience with a parent, whether it's physical or emotional or spiritual, or there's all kinds of forms of abuse. What I want you to know is, if you don't hear anything else I say today, hear this. That is not God. And that is not God's love for you. God's love for you is so incredible. There's not even a vocabulary that you can put around it. He loves you so much that he doesn't care what you've done. He doesn't care. You're sitting here this morning, you like, you say you don't care what I've done. If you knew what I did this week, I'll tell you what, folks, this is God's house. Trust me. We've done some stuff. Can we be real? We're real people. If God was judging us by what we've done, none of us deserve to be here. That's why we needed Jesus to come and rescue us. I was talking to my buddy Krister over here this week. We were having coffee, and look, he's drinking coffee now. Yeah! And we were talking about the love of God. And Krister's just brilliant. He's got one of those brilliant minds, and so we're talking through, like, God's love, and he's into all the theological stuff. I told him yesterday, this is why I like to hang out with him, because I like to be around wise people. It makes me feel wise. And so, especially people like Krister, because some people that are wise make you feel like an idiot. You know, but when you're with people that have the heart of God, honestly, Christopher has the heart of God and has compassion, when he's explaining things, you're just like, wow, this is so great. And we were having this conversation about God's love, and we were talking about Jesus. And you know the phrase, if you've been in church a long time, you hear people say all the time, you know, when God looks at you, he doesn't see you, he sees Jesus. Have you heard that? And Christopher said, you know, I actually don't agree with that statement. And I was like, you know what's funny is I never even thought, I've preached that before. You know, that's one bad thing about having a microphone and podcast, is you can go back and listen to yourself 6 years ago and be like, oh my gosh, I don't even believe that anymore. Whoops. So this is kind of, everything I say is with a disclaimer that maybe in 3 years, it'll be, I don't know. But what I know is Jesus is Lord and God is good. We'll just stop there. Okay, so, but I've said that to people. Don't worry, God doesn't see your sin. He doesn't see your brokenness, because of the cross, he just sees Jesus. The problem with that is, then why did God create humanity if all he needed was Jesus? Why does it say we're fearfully and wonderfully made and he knows that full well? Why does he say he created us in his image if he just created us to all look like Jesus? Our characteristics should look like Jesus, but your personality, your strengths, your individual characteristics within you are you. And when God looks at you, because of the cross, he no longer sees the sin, but he sees all of you, and he loves you like you are. He loves you. He loves you. Doesn't matter how much money's in your bank account. Doesn't matter who you just made mad this week. It doesn't matter what people have said to you and told you you're never worth it, you'll never measure up, you'll never fully get to where you are because of the way you were brought up or the color of your skin or how you identify or whatever crap, can I say that, is going on in our world right now. And the church is the worst at this, guys. We're the worst at dividing. The Bible says a house divided cannot stand. This platform should never be for a social or political agenda. It should be for the kingdom of God. But it's also not a place to abuse people because of an agenda. And the church has become so known for this that people are leaving in droves because they're like, well, how can I come to a God who can't receive me as me? I talk to parents all the time who are struggling with their kids because of choices they're making, right? I struggle with Weston when he pulls the Tupperware out and bounces it all over the floor. I'm like, yeah, right? That's not really a struggle, I know. But you know what's cool about the heart of a parent when you talk to a parent about even struggles their kids are going through? Everything they hurt for their child is because they just want what's best for their kid. Right? If you're in here and you're a parent, you just want what's best for them. If you're in here and you don't have kids, your parent just wants what's best for you in their heart of hearts, even if they haven't shown that to you. And I think what we've done so long as a church is we've told God's kids, you must act this way. You don't say this or this, and you don't do this or this, and you build all these things of what you're supposed to do. And everything that we try and try and try and try and try to do feels like it never measures up to God. Because it can't. God didn't ask you to try. the love of God for you, all you do is this. You receive it. You just receive it. You just open your arms, you open your heart, and you say, God, thank you for your love. And if you're in here this morning and you're going, I don't know if I can receive that love because I've never been shown that love through another human. I get it. I know. I had amazing, amazing parents. When I was 18, I didn't think that. But at 31, I had amazing parents because I've lived a little bit longer and I've talked to enough people who don't have amazing parents. And I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful for my amazing parents. But here's what I want you to know. You have an amazing parent and his name is God. Jesus can be your parent. God wants to be in the place that fills all the voids that you feel and everything that you feel like doesn't measure up and all those things that maybe your earthly parent has told you it's not enough. God says you are enough. You are enough. So open your heart up and receive my love for you. As we wrap this up this morning, I have to sign into my computer. Lord, fix the printer this week, please. I didn't get to any of my notes. I'm sorry. Let's do this. Let's close with this. If you turn your Bibles to Ephesians, one of my favorite chapters. It's funny that we don't ever contrast God's love with the love of a parent. And sometimes it's because we've had it done so poorly. But when you look at a really, really good parent, sometimes we see that love between, like I'm telling you guys, I think I'm kind of tender this morning because Kelsey and I were watching Chicago Fire last night, y'all. And the one where the adoption, they adopt the kid and then they take the kid away. And we've been talking about adoption and we're sitting there bawling. Like, and I just like imagine Weston being taken. And like, I laugh, but it's actually not funny, right? Like, if you've lost a child, that the pain of that is so deep, you can't even express it. The way Weston came into the world even for us was really painful, and he's here. So to go through that and then lose it, you can't even express it. But I said to Kels, like, I didn't know that I could love something so much. I didn't know. I'm not a kid person. Not usually. I mean, like, it's crazy because I run a nonprofit that's for kids and a church that's building a church that our kids can keep building. But, okay, so I love the next generation. However, I don't want to run a daycare. Let's put it that way, all right? That is my version of hell. But that little boy running around the house, banging the Tupperware, going over to, we had this little table in our living room, and we had this vase that we got when we were first married at Salvation Army, so it wasn't like some, you know, huge thing, but it was really pretty, and it kind of fit our decor, and Kelsey and I both think that we're Chip and Joanna, so we like the decor stuff, and so it was on this table, and Kelsey said, we probably should move that, because Weston will probably get it, and because I'm lazy, I didn't, and so Weston goes over one day, and I went out in the other room, and I hear this big crash, because this vase is like this big, and it's made out of clay, and so you just hear this, and I go out there, and the vase is all over the living room. We have wood floors, so it just, you know, flies across the floor, and it's under the couch, and it's all over. And Weston's just standing there crying, looking at me so scared. And so I walked over, and I said, you stupid kid! I can't believe you... No. Y'all got a little scared there. Come back next week. I'll finish the story. No. I walked over to his little crying self, and he was probably only a year. He just started walking, and he like looked up at me in this fear and this terror, and I scooped him up, and I held him, and I walked out of that room where all the mess was, because why stay there, right? And there's just stuff on the floor, and I took him out to the front room, and I held him until he stopped crying. And then when he got back down to go play, I went in the room and cleaned up the mess. That's how God feels about you. See, we think, oh, but God, I messed up, and I gotta clean it all up, and I'll help you clean it, God, and so then you just find yourself more in a mess, right? Then you don't know what the issue is, and God's like, stop. Receive my love. I'll pick you up. I'll pull you out of what I need to pull you. The Bible says, out of the miry clay, he'll lift you out of. And then I'll set you where I need you, and then I'll go back and clean it all up. That's the love of God for you. Look at Ephesians chapter 3, and we'll close with this. In fact, you should stand up, because if you don't, I'll keep going. Because I didn't even get to any of my points or my poems. Next week, I'm so glad there's more days in the month or year or whatever. I don't know what it's called. Anyways, okay. Look at Ephesians chapter 3, starting in verse 16. It says, I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have the power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and how long and how high and how deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge. We can't understand it, as Solomon said, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. God loves you right where you are. And what he told me to tell you is he loves you. So receive that love this morning. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you that your word says that while we were still in our mess, while we were still trying to clean up ourselves, you came and gave your son for us so that we could just live in a loving relationship with you. I pray, God, that you would help us to just step into that love this week, that we'd receive the love of a parent, God. The characteristics of our earthly fathers and earthly mothers that have been so good for many of us, God, let us receive those. And then I pray this morning, God, for anyone here who would say, I've not experienced a good parent. I've not experienced a love for me that was tangible and that was good and that was kind. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would be that to them. That they would understand your love, that they would receive your love, and that they would step in to the love that you have for them, even this week, God. I pray anywhere in their souls, in their minds, in their hearts, God, where they're just broken, that your loving compassion would come over them and heal them, God, from the inside out. And that you would let them hear your voice this week say to them, I love you. I love you. I love you just where you are, exactly who you are in this moment. I love you. And help us to receive that love, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Awesome. Love you guys. Julian's going to close us out.